Hello and happy Sunday. Hope this this here little video is finding you happy and healthy. Hope you're having a great weekend. I have had a long week. I'm actually pretty tired. But there are a couple things I want to talk to you about, so stick with me. Let's dig in. So I find myself kind of in limbo on the many cases that I'm looking into right now. Not a lot that is happening, I guess. There's a lot of hurry up and wait on the stuff that I'm working on right now. And so I was talking with my wife and, you know, wondering what her thoughts were on what kind of updates I might offer for you guys today. And she goes, you know, when you go off and you meet one of the families that are left behind because their loved one has been, you know, has been killed, something horrific has happened, you always come home and you tell me about the families. And that's the stuff that she's most interested in. Because I do find that in all of these tragedies, there are some really, really remarkable people who are left behind, oftentimes to fight for justice for their loved one. And justice is one of those words that I personally don't think that you can find justice for a murder. I just don't think that you can. I think that justice requires restitution, and in the case of that kind of violent crime, and there are other violent crimes that take away innocence, like kill innocence, there is no restitution. So I don't like using that word unless we're talking about, you know, you can make restitution for stealing something, I guess, right? So there is justice in that, but anyway, I find it's a word that's not very descriptive for the things that these family, for what these families are trying to get. But as I've thought about maybe sharing a couple of personal experiences with these families that I've gotten to know on a personal level, they've invited me to their homes. Several of them are out of state, you know, and I will travel long distances to get there. And they treat me like an honored guest, or even in some cases like I'm one of their own. But as I was thinking about that, I just kind of feel like that might be a little too much of an invasion of their privacy and their trust. So I don't want to give any specific examples, but I want you guys to know, I think the thing that I want to communicate here, my wife has a very good point, that the people that are left behind, the moms, the dads, the brothers and sisters, the nieces and nephews, the spouses, these are people that have been victimized in a similarly violent way as the victims of the crimes themselves. And I personally am just overwhelmed by just how inspiring they are to just go on. You know, not even the fight. Like most of them fight, right? And they're fighting a system that doesn't want to help them. Or they're fighting a system, I guess if I'm going to be more charitable, they're fighting people in a system who believe that they have, to the best of their knowledge or their ability, helped these families, but they haven't, and at least in my opinion. And so these families go into fight mode, and that's impressive enough. But the more impressive thing, at least to me, is the resilience to like get up every day, to just wake up and get out of bed and make their bed and, you know, go to work and be successful in that endeavor. Many of these people who have family members who have died tragically in horrific crimes, they still have families that they need to support, you know, survivors that need, they need to support, like as far as giving them the necessities of life, like being a mom and being a dad and things like that. And they have to go to their professions where they have to work professionally, and they have to be able to do that while everything inside of them is broken. So while I don't feel like it's, I feel like it's crossing the line to share some of the specifics, I just want you guys to know that I am aware and I am conscious of just how heroic it is to just continue life. It's pretty impressive. Now, I think I started out this video by saying that I've had a long week. I'm tired. I thought that I would share with you guys, just kind of in that vein, kind of the struggle that I have been going through for on certain cases, maybe as an illustration of the struggle that these families go through, knowing that what I am going through is nothing, right? It's nothing in comparison to what the loved ones of these, you know, I'm thinking of like Josh and Sandy Greenberg and, you know, Scott and Nancy Elmquist and Amy Hartsock and Leslie Brill Mezerol, you know, Sue Marino. These are people that have lost loved ones in tragic ways, and they have decided to try to fight. The hardest part, at least in my opinion, well, for me, it's not the hardest part for them, or I wouldn't even be able to say what the hardest part for them is. But for me, I guess the quest to get information is the most difficult part, getting as much information, because if there is a investigative organization that has endeavored to solve a crime or has determined that, hey, there was no crime here, and you disagree as a family member or as a private investigator, as a citizen, and I'm not saying all of them do this, but their natural reaction to that will be to protect themselves. They feel, or they may feel, attacked, and they're going to want to protect themselves against that perceived attack. And so it's very difficult, even with laws on the book that are public data laws, public records laws, things like that, that are designed to hedge against the kind of behavior that I'm talking about, they still will want to protect themselves. And actually, guys, I mean, I don't blame them. I think that were I in their position, I might too, especially if I feel justified in whatever action or inaction that I took. So these people, detectives, investigators, you know, CSIs, medical examiners, coroners, sheriffs and deputies and police officers, all these people, they are people. So they're going to act like people do. But there are tricks that one can use, or I don't know that I would say tricks, maybe tools. There are tools in the toolbox that can be used in order to get people to do what they're supposed to do. And I thought I'd share with you something that's actually coming up on the Murder Between Friends podcast, some of the, I guess, techniques that I use to get people to do what I want them to do. Number one, police officers are notoriously bad at calling you back. And again, I don't blame them. I mean, they've got a tough job, especially when we're talking about homicide investigators and investigators of other violent crimes. They have a lot on their plate. And by the way, I don't want people to get the idea that I am anti-police in anything that I say or show on my channel. The police, by and large, do a very good job at their job. There are just times when they don't, and those are the times that we in the true crime community kind of focus on them, right? So, police officers are notoriously bad at calling you back. They're really bad at giving information. And they're taught from the academy all the way through all of their continuing education that they shouldn't be giving up information on a case. That there are detrimental side effects to doing that. So they'll never want to... If you're calling them asking for information, they're already not going to want to give you that information most of the time, at least in my experience. But also, they just have a lot on their plate. But what I've learned is that if a police officer believes or an investigator believes that you have something to give them, then they are more than willing to call you back. I learned this because when I was investigating the Amanda Winkowski case, which I continue to do, by the way, but as I was really in the deep throes of that investigation, I wanted to talk to, after looking through all the documents that were provided me by Amanda's mom, Leslie, I wanted to talk to the investigator, and I called and I left messages and never got a call back. But I found a chief of police in a small town, kind of in the Niagara Falls area near Buffalo, which is where Amanda's case happened, who had, at the time of Amanda's disappearance, had been a lower level officer. I really should have brought some water with me. I'm getting parched. And he called me back. Like, it was really remarkable. I don't know if it's just his personality to be helpful, or he's in a small enough place that he has enough bandwidth to do that. But the way that I found him is I was putting in a what's called a FOIL in the state of New York, a Freedom of Information Law request. And I put in my FOIL, and he responded back to me really quickly and said, "Hey, you've really written this so that the way that it's written," he said, you won't get what you're looking for. Give me a call when you have a minute." And that I got that email back within a few minutes of me sending in the FOIL. So I called him back, and he goes, yeah, okay, listen. And he gave me a bunch of pointers on how to rewrite it, because I'd sent the FOIL to him. But he knew that it was some other agency that needed to fulfill it. So he helped me rewrite that FOIL. And as I was talking to him about that, he's like, "Yeah, I was on that case. In fact, I was the one that knocked on the door. I was the first officer that knocked on a door looking for Amanda Winkowski. We took it seriously here, as opposed to Buffalo, who didn't take it seriously." So anyway, I started talking with him, and I was telling him some of the things that I had found out. And he goes, "You know, you really should call Detective Evans in Buffalo and let her know what you told me. That's valuable information." And I said, "Well, I've called her multiple times. I've never gotten a call back. I've left a lot of voicemail for her. And he goes, drop my name. Just let her know that you were talking with me and I told you to call. So, and I'm like combining experiences here because he told me that in person a couple of weeks after the foil. But anyway, after I got back from a trip up to his office, I made a call to the detective and said, hey, Chief so-and-so told me that I ought to let you know that this happened. Give me a call. That day, I got a call back. So, I guess that's the long story of how I learned this technique. That if you want something out of a police officer who's investigating a case that you're interested in, call them and drop a name. Like, what I will do sometimes, say I'm calling whatever, Pittsburgh police, I will look around the little towns, say within like an hour of Pittsburgh, and I will find the name of a detective, and I will say, hey, Detective so-and-so, hey, I was talking with Detective so-and-so, and then I thought I ought to give you this information when I leave a voicemail for them, because they hardly ever answer their phone. Anyway, I always get a call back. So that's a little technique that if you are trying to investigate cases that you can use. It only works once per person. So only use it if they are not calling you back after multiple times. And understand that if they feel like they have you've wasted their time, that'll be the last time you'll be able to use that. But I think that that's one technique that I use. Another one, I was talking to Sherilyn about this, Sherilyn Dale. We were talking about the Jahlia Davis case. So as you guys know, we're working on a collaboration on the Jahlia Davis case. It's a big case, big in that we've got lots of documents, photos, videos, audio, like recording and stuff like that. So, but I didn't always have that. I did that through a FOIA request in West Virginia, Freedom of Information Act request in the state of Virginia. And before that, what I had done is I had gone to the Justice for Jahlia case page, or the Justice for Jahlia Facebook page that her family put together, and I was pulling down documents. They were just like photos of documents, JPEGs, really low quality, really hard to read. I was organizing them, and I just felt like there was stuff in there that was missing, and so I decided to do a FOIA to the Wood County Sheriff's Office. And not surprisingly, when I put in my request, I never heard back. Like, I looked up the law and they had 5 days to respond. And it wasn't 5 days to meet my request to get the documents, it was 5 days to respond. That response is usually, hey, we've got your request, we need a little bit more time. Then there's usually some kind of like process that they follow in accordance with their law, with their, in that case, West Virginia, their FOIA law. So I waited for 5 days and I didn't get anything. And man, I'm shaking all over the place. Sorry about that, guys. And so on day 7, which I think it was business days, I sent a reminder email over to the person that I'd been directed to as the FOIA, the person who was responsible for this case. Just a quick reminder saying, hey, I haven't heard back from you. And then I waited another couple days. I didn't hear back. In my email that I sent to him, I, you know, quoted the law that he was in breach of. and really required him to work on the on my request. A couple more days go by, and I still hadn't heard from this officer. So that's when I pull out my secret weapon that I'm going to share with you guys. Okay? I'm sorry about the shaking. My secret weapon when trying to get a, you know, documents and I'm just being ignored. And I learned, I can't remember how I learned this, but I learned that every, in the United States, every officer of government or every position in government that is required to take an oath, so like sheriffs, clerks of court, school boards, city councils, those types of things, county commissions, anybody who has to take an oath is also required to have an insurance policy to ensure that they will abide by that oath. And typically it's a bond. It's like a public officer bond. The other thing is that anybody who works for anybody who took an oath, so say, say in a jurisdiction, the prothonotary takes an oath, but the clerks or the assistants within the prothonotary's office don't, well, they are working under the oath that the prothonotary took. So it's really anybody in government is insured against breaking their oath. They don't publish this anywhere, nope, that I've found in any jurisdiction that I've looked at. They don't say, hey, here's our insurance policy that you can make a claim on just in case we break our oath. They never do that, so you have to dig. So what I did is, in Wood County, I reached out to the court clerk, and I said, hey, can I get a copy of this person's oath? Because it'll be written, and they have to sign it, right? It's not just them putting their hand on their holy book of choice and reciting the oath. No, there's a document. So the clerk of courts got me a certified copy of that oath. And then I started, because he was a county employee, I started the county and I started asking for, I would like the public official bond, please, like a certified copy of it. And usually at that point, they have no idea what you're talking about because nobody has ever asked them for that. And so it will require persistence, and you will have to say no, according to the state of Virginia, and you'll have to look at the statute. In that case, it was West Virginia. I had to look up the statute and tell them no, in the state of West Virginia, he is required to have a bond or some kind of insurance policy. I would like a copy of that policy, please. And after about five different, being passed through like five different people, you will ultimately find the person who knows about the bond. It'll be like the county solicitor, or, you know, it'll be somebody who has been there for 40 years and goes, yeah, okay, I know about this because I've filed it a million times, or, you know, I've negotiated rates a million times, or whatever. And then you need a certified copy of that bond. Now, typically, I'll be honest with you, once word gets out that you are looking for that bond or that insurance policy, they will do whatever it is that you want them to do. Because if somebody makes a claim against their insurance policy, they usually have a very large deductible that they have to pay. I know in Wood County, it was 25 grand. So had I made a claim on their, they had an umbrella policy for the whole county. If I had made a claim against that, then Wood County would have had to pay 25 grand. And if I were to prove, which I could have, that he broke his oath, I think in that case it was about a $500,000 penalty. So, you know, it's not that I wanted $500,000, it's that I wanted him to fulfill his oath. So once word got out that I was doing that, and I was not secretive about why I was doing that. They would ask me, why are you asking about this oath or this bond? And nobody's ever asked for the bond before. I'd go, oh, it's very simple. Chief so-and-so, you know, or deputy chief so-and-so is not fulfilling his oath. And because I put in a FOIL 10 days ago, I think at that point it was 9 days. So I'm going to have to put a claim on the insurance policy. And that afternoon I got a response. Dear Mr. Fish, I'm so sorry that it took so long. I was waiting for permission from the prosecutor, blah, 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 blah. And then he arranged to get me the documents. And I've gone through that process multiple times. And guys, it doesn't even matter how old the case is either. Like, Jalea Davis, that happened 12 years ago, almost. I can't remember the date off the top of my head. I think it was 2011. But I've done that on cases that are 40 years old. I've done it on one 52-year-old case where I've had to take it to that point. So that's, I guess, a little technique that I thought I would share with you as you are digging into cases trying to uncover the truth. And by the way, guys, oftentimes I will look into a case and then after reading everything and sometimes watching video and sometimes listening to interviews, I sometimes will say to myself, I think the police got this right. And so I try to go in every case with an open mind. You know, when the Elmquists reached out to me, they told me what their concerns were. And over the course of a couple weeks, I let them know that I wasn't interested in just telling their story. I would like to see for myself and come to my own conclusion first. And to their credit, everything that they sent my way. Even the stuff that was maybe a little personally embarrassing for them. And after reading everything, listening to everything, I came to the conclusion that I think the police got it wrong. And that's why I am pursuing David's case. So I guess that's what I wanted to share with you on my Sunday drive today. Just, you know, as citizen detectives, there are little techniques that we can use that will help us to get what we want. Won't always work, but as we go along, I think there might be some of you who are interested in starting a podcast or a blog or a YouTube channel and a true crime YouTube channel or blog or podcast. And I think that is absolutely 100% terrific. There is room for all of us here. This isn't a zero sum kind of thing where there's only enough room for a certain amount of citizen detectives to look at cases, right? Even if you have the maybe goal like I do of doing it full time as your job, as your living that you would bring home to your family, there's room for you. You won't be taking advertisers or sponsors away from anyone else. There's room for everyone. So if you're thinking about doing that, I invite you to do it. And the hardest part is just starting. But when you start, just know that you're going on a journey where you're going to be learning new things, new skills, and hopefully you will apply maybe what you've learned through maybe your normal 9-to-5 kind of professional life, or maybe what you studied in school but didn't pursue professionally. You know, you will use those things and you will bring something different to the table that nobody else brings. I read a comment on my channel last night of somebody who said, hey, I haven't checked out your channel in a while. And then on this long comment, talked about all the channels that that person loves to watch and for what reason. And when, I think it was a she, but I can't remember. But when they described my channel, they described me as their document guy. And that's kind of the little, that's the thing about me. I like the paperwork, right? I want to read. I want the data. So whatever it is about you that is your strength, you have a place here. And many of you, I know I've kind of gone off on a weird tangent here, but many of you might know that my background is in information technology and computer science. I have no background in investigation, in criminology, or criminal science, or any of that. I have no background in that. But what I found is the skills that I developed over decades of troubleshooting whatever an application, a certain software or web application or whatever, as I have spent decades troubleshooting things that I have built or what other people have built, I have been able to use those skills as I go through the process of troubleshooting a case. So anyway, if you're thinking about starting a YouTube channel in true crime or a podcast or writing a blog, you bring something to the table that nobody else brings. So I think you should do it. I don't know how many of you that are watching this are you know, qualify as wanting to start a channel or to create content, but for those few of you who are, jump in and do it. We'd love to have you. We want you here. So with that, I think that's a good place to stop. You guys may have noticed, and I'm coming back into town, so you guys may have noticed on my community tab, I posted some pictures of me doing some research on tool mark, I guess, science on bullets. And this is in relation to the Delphi case, Abby and Libby case. So that will be my next video during the week. Probably Wednesday is when I'm going to try to get it out. We're going to go over the science or non-science, according to the lawyers of Richard Allen, of the kind of markings that guns leave on bullets as they are either fired or otherwise. I'm focused on the casings themselves, not the bullets, the cartridges. But as they cycle through like a semi-automatic gun, I'm taking a closer look at the forensic value of that. So I'll see you hopefully on Wednesday. And thanks for watching. Thanks for sticking it out to the end. See you later, guys.
Thank you very much for watching this video. If you liked what you saw, please subscribe to my channel. And if you have any comments or questions, please leave them below.